Enterprise TV, a tradition of truth.
Hi guys, as you know, this is Let's Talk About Tomorrow, where we discuss anything and everything relating to Gen Z. I'm your host Petrina, and I'm going to be introducing my guest right now.
Petrina, what are you doing? You have started again.
What are you talking about?
You know what? You are beginning to affect my mental health, and I'm not good for you.
Again. What are you talking about?
I'm not good for you.
I will not introduce you.
What do you mean? Did I tell you I don't want to introduce myself by myself? What are
just
you doing?
Just like
wow. It's not. Okay. You know what? At this point, we are going to talk about mental health today, and there is absolutely nothing we're going to do about it.
Please let me introduce my guest.
By all means, please.
We have Victor.
Thank you.
Welcome. Thank you for coming.
That's the Victor.
We also have David.
The fine boy David.
Honor to be here.
Fineness is typical of David. Welcome. And obviously, we also have Barrister Ivan Tofeli in the house.
My pleasure.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. I have to protect my mental health. This is something that we hear a lot of times, and we also see. So today, let us understand why we always see this. But first, we'll be focusing on, you know, our home life. What do we mean when we say that our mental health is, you know, affected? And why is it that it's at home that our mental health is always challenged? By the way, I'm referring to, you know, young people living in Nigeria. So, first, let me ask this question. Why, what exactly is mental health? What is this?
Who would like to chime in to that question?
Okay, mental health is the well-being, your emotional well-being, your... People mistake mental health for mental illness.
Okay.
The mental health here is not a negative word. It's only negative when you add bad.
Yes.
Oh.
Then it's positive when you add good. And now, in our African homes, our parents are so focused on keeping our stomachs fed, making sure that child is safe. They are not making sure our mental health is well protected. So at some point, if you go and meet your African parent and tell them, mommy, daddy, this is what I'm going through, sometimes they will not.
They will dismiss you.
Like,
and if you keep, they keep dismissing you, you start to have a bad mental health because you will not be able to approach them and tell them this is what is going on.
Okay.
You begin to feel bad for yourself. You begin to, at some point you will grow depression. And depression is growing high in Africa now. In Nigeria, the rate of depression, people are getting depressed, people are committing suicide, it's becoming more, and it's young people. And this is because their parents did not give them face that, okay, how can you be in a house with someone? This one now, I know that everybody would have faced it once or twice in life. How will you be at home and you are feeling bad? I mean, you're walking in front of your mom, you're passing in front of your dad, and they cannot see that, okay, my child is feeling bad. Something is wrong with my child.
Okay.
They'll just leave it, and in the end, something bad is going to happen. They'll not understand their child in the end.
Maybe just chip into what he has said.
Okay.
Like, in our African family, our parents assume that, okay, you just wait to just go to school, have a good grade, and just have a good results. And that is also like, come home, and just eat, sleep, go to school the next day. But they don't really understand, this one is apart from being, going to school. At least what I'm facing, like, for example, maybe an adult of 18 years now, she's having a relationship, like, issue like that. She cannot, like, she'll be afraid that.
She can't confide in her parents.
Exactly, you get
okay.
me. She can't confide in her parents.
Okay.
Like, okay, now she'll be having second thought that, if I go and tell my parents, how
you will collect.
You collect.
Barrister.
Yes.
If you've noticed something that has been, what's the word, consistent in the two takes now,
yes.
Parents, we can push it to your time.
Yes.
You are representing that generation now.
Yes.
Why is it that they can't, what's the word, they can't understand, or why? Why is this disconnect when it comes to awareness of mental...
Your parents grew up at an era where emphasis was placed on self-reliance.
Okay.
Yes. It was about self-reliance. It was about you overcoming your challenges, breaking through the barriers and the fortitudes of struggles and emerging victorious at every point in time. It was an era of self-reliance. Conversely, the Gen Z of today are not cultured in self-reliance because the parents also caused it. Yes. I know some of your parents must have gone to fight your teachers when you were in
yeah, yeah.
They have a statement that I don't want my children to go through what I went through.
Yes.
What they went through that made them self-reliant, strong and reliant. When they protect their children throughout the phases of life, they not expect the same children to face mental health issues and overcome it themselves. Whereas the same parents were the one who protected them from the challenges, any challenges of life, ensure that they stopped at nothing to make sure that they, well, self-preservation, what they call it, providing for your children is a task, a responsibility. Taking them to the best of schools is a responsibility. Security for them is a responsibility. But you see, they were not given that responsibility. In the days of your parents, you close from the school and you go to farm to take your lunch. Then when you take your lunch in the farm, you join your parents to continue. The parents of your parents, your ancestors, your progenitors, lived in harder times than your parents. You understand?
Okay.
Then you, as Gen Zs, you are living in a better time than your parents lived in terms of welfare.
Yes, obviously.
So now, if you want to subject your parents to your emotional challenges,
yes.
Now, they believe they have done their best for you. They believe they protected you all through. And now you are about graduating or you are now serving. You still want to drag them into your mental evasion or your mental instability. For those who genuinely have mental health challenges. Like he said, mental health is not a bad word. It's not mental. If you are mentally healthy, of course you'll be more productive.
Obviously, yes.
But if you are mentally sick, meaning that you'll be emotionally downcast, or they will say you have deficits mental deficit. So you will not be as stable as you should.
Well, you said we want to drag our parents into our, how did you put it, into our mental But it's not really that. If you have a parent, that person is also supposed to be your friend.
Yes.
So you should be able to confide in your parents when you're having problems. Mm-hmm. They should be able to help you. And not only should they also be able to help you, they should not add to it.
Yes.
Because that is what we are talking about. A lot of times, parents add to it.
They should not add to it.
Yes, they
emphasis
add to
on
add
to
it.
Do you get it?
Yeah, but you know what you define as adding to it is when your parents expect you to undertake your natural responsibility, chores and all that. Sometimes we decide to be adding to it.
We disagree, sir. We disagree. That doesn't necessarily...
What does it mean to add to it?
To add to it, say for instance now, some of the things that, okay, before you come in, some of the things that, what's the word, contributes to mental health challenges, issues, so to speak, for most of the Gen Zs when growing up, is probably some sort of identity crisis or struggling with. We're living our reality now in our own generation is the advent of social media, and now evidently, do you get it? Is part of everything we do, even assignments. They sometimes direct us to that place, so it's part of our life. Because we go there, there are a lot of things we see, a lot of things we are exposed to, and you see our parents say stuff like, "You see, this horrible. It is fat. You are just fat eating my food." And this person might be uniquely struggling with
insecure.
Yeah. You are talking about verbal abuse. A lot of parents, to be fair and objective, a lot of parents don't know where to draw the boundaries.
Yes.
Okay, there's verbal abuse. Verbal abuse is an offense. Anything you do to diminish the human prestige or the person's self-esteem is dangerous.
And it's an offense?
It's an offense.
So my parents can be, they can also...
If you look at the Child Rights Act,
okay,
that is why that it is stated there that a child is entitled to a name. It's entitled not to be subjected to hard labor, okay, or child labor, traffic. It's entitled not to be abused. This is verbal abuse. So from section 23 of the Child Act, you see all the rights of the child.
Oh.
Okay, and parents should have a copy of the Child Rights Act. Now, the Gen Zs too should have a copy of the Child Rights Act, where you're able to see the lines, the responsibilities are clear there. Okay, so because when I know a lot of parents that do that, look at him, fat, eating my food and all that.
Mm-hmm.
I have done.
You can attest to that.
You see, you in a way should also educate your parents.
Hmm.
Don't be.
They will listen.
You will not tell them that you, daddy, mommy, sit down, let me educate you. No, that's not happening. Your dad will look at you and say, what did she say? So, there's a way you will do it. You will draw their attention to videos, to, you know, there are activities all over the internet and all that. That what you are trying to say is that this particular issue should be addressed this way. You understand? There are people who are very close to their parents. There are some persons who are not close to their parents at all.
Mm-hmm.
So it depends on the family structure. But the most important thing is that if you are having mental issue and all that, it's something you must, as a matter of fact, 70% is your burden to bear. But the Gen Z don't want to bear any burden. I'm telling you, sometimes they use mental health into blackmail.
I like that place you went to now, but
that's exact thing of parents adding to the mental health of their children, the bad mental health of their children. Imagine your child is fat. She goes, girls specifically, because they're always body shaming themselves, girls. Imagine you have a female child and she goes to school. After receiving all the body shaming, after they have insulted her in class, she will not come home tired and stressed, and you too will be adding. And you'll be calling her names. And this child here now, you are probably not doing anything. Are you expecting a child of, let's give an age range of 11 to 16? Because that is when you begin to notice your own body.
Yes.
Are you expecting are you expecting a child of 11 to 15 to know that, okay, if I want to start losing weight, I start doing this and this, when there's no one that's telling her? Instead, everybody is putting mouth into her mouth and telling her that it's causing a stigma. And this stigma in the community that is causing, because even if at home, let's be frank, if at home they are saying you are fat, and out there they are saying you are fat, you know that if you compare, out there is worse than indoors. Because your mom, your dad, your brothers might not go far, but people will add insults. You are fat, you are this, you are that. They don't make you feel useless. And then you come home, the same treatment too. That kind of child now, I know that the child will go and hide somewhere in the house and will not want to show her face, will just be in the room. And that will cause a lot of distance between the child and the parents. And when the child eventually grows to a certain age of small freedom, give that kind of child a little freedom and someone that loves them out there, they will run away.
You are talking about rejection.
Yes.
It's a very big issue in the family front. And I know that parents don't really... Parents are preoccupied with school fees and the rest of things like that. Sometimes both sides are working. We should also know that the dynamics of society have changed.
Yes.
When we want to blame parents, we should also look at what are the possibilities that my parents never explored. Were there ever possibilities or opportunities for them to have done better? They didn't do that. So whatever you do, you factor in your parents as you look at the dynamics. Whether truly they just abandoned you, or they couldn't have done better than they did, or circumstances and situations were just
different. One thing I found is, as much as I try to come from the standpoint of, you people didn't notice, you people could have done better, you don't see genuinely, it just might not be their fault. Because sometimes you cannot give what you don't have. What I'm saying so is because when growing up, when I was with mommy and would maybe in the afternoon, maybe she's back from work, where I was just watching evening news and everything, and we just see, oh, this boy he took his life because his girlfriend ditched him. They look with disbelief. My mom and my dad, I see that unison in character. They don't understand how a generation got to a place that being jilted by a girl or a guy would translate to my will to live is gone.
Yeah.
Or writing jam 3-4 times, you hear it took sniper. I mean, like, do you know how many times
we did
a lot of work? Nobody even they would sometimes say how in their own time mental health was not necessarily a discussion because everybody was.
No, it just emerged. You know, even the millennials, the generation before yours, are the millennials.
Okay,
those ones don't really care about mental health as such as the Gen Zs.
Yeah, you know, not as much.
When I say millennials, those born in not too far away before your generation. So the case is one that, for me, I think every individual will have to look for what works for them and tie up to it.
And find a way to take responsibility.
Yes, yes, most of the times, you see, these things you push to your parents by law, okay, are already extricated from your wahalas and woes once you are 18.
Mm-hmm.
In very civilized countries
that's
like
a very
the US,
scary thought too.
Okay. Yes, it's scary, I know. Because it takes a lot of independent in Nigeria. There are people who have gone to school, graduated, served, and they came back to home, their houses to become a second childhood. Because there's nowhere to work. There's nowhere to go to. So, but in civilized economies, once you are 18, okay, the hold that your parents have over you is shrunk.
Mm-hmm.
So you cannot take responsibility. You can begin to. That is when in America they start to tell you about the Fifth Amendment, because it gave them liberty. You understand?
Yes.
So our society is different. Okay, we still cling to our parents even after we are 18. We are still making demands. We are still expecting them to be emotionally responsible for our own.
But shouldn't they be?
I know they should to an extent now when you are under 18. After 18, they should not.
The extent should be reduced.
Advisory rule.
That's what he's saying now. After 18, normally, all over the world, the standard for the most part of the world, the standard for adults.
Not like
the
abandonment.
It's not total abandonment.
They allow you to explore.
Situation. Exactly. You spread your wings and, you know, just fly. Let's move that thought as we go on a quick break and we'll be right back. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back. You're watching Let's Talk About Tomorrow on Enterprise TV, and we're still talking about mental health, about Gen Zs. So I think at this point we can take personal experiences. Who wants to go first? You know.
Okay, let me go first.
Okay, Victor.
Okay. There was my personal experience was like, just when I want to enter the university,
okay,
I was planning to process my first jam. I wrote my first jam and I didn't do well. So when I saw my classmate, when SST didn't,
I knew
right. I saw my classmate getting higher.
Tell
grades,
me about
I was feeling
it.
Depressed. And
tell
I
me
my
about
like,
it.
Why is not my own now?
Do you get
difference from that? I'm like, okay. I got home. I told my friends about the video. They were like feeling somehow about it. Like, but don't worry, I will just write the jam again. So long run after graduation, everybody went their ways. Everybody entered schools. They left me and my jam with me together. So I picked up the jam form. I started preparing. So as I picked the positive for UniBen. So long run, I was waiting for admission. I did not see. I was becoming depressed. That in the essence that they even scammed me of money.
Okay.
So I lose hope. They're like, Victor, don't worry yourself, admission will come on. Well, finally, admission came, Sha.
Okay.
So the admission came, they gave me a call that my parents was not even in support of it. So I was like, I want to do this course, so at least I won't stay at home. My dad was like, I should do transfer later. But we were like, this transfer of a thing, it is 50-50 chance. If it does not work out, you continue with the course.
Oh, yes, we heard that.
So my dad was not giving me options that I should choose. And I was left that, okay, this is the only option left now. And if this transfer of a thing did not work out, I have to go with that course. And me personally, I don't like the course.
Okay,
so
that's getting interesting.
I was like, okay, let me just calm down again. And I wrote
again.
So the long run again, I wrote again. And when my friend was telling me, Victor, I'm in school already, they're like, don't worry, I'm still processing my own. God's grace, we see my. I processed it again, and I picked another school. So I was preparing, I was actually applying for law. So they didn't give me law, they actually gave me mass comm. I was like, okay, mass comm is still a good one, let me just actually
do it
for it. So this process of mental, during that period, I was having sleepless nights. My mom would be like, Vito, don't worry yourself for this thing. I was like, you won't understand because you're not in my shoe. Because imagine waking up in the morning, seeing somebody, I'm going to school. What am I now doing?
So in this case, would you say your parents were supportive?
Thank you.
They were actually supportive in terms of they were not making me feel depressed. They got the time, they started praying for me, started encouraging me, and I should not really bother about the whole issue.
Your parents did accolade.
Do you get special will?
It is safe to say that it's not true that every parent don't really care.
Yes.
There are exceptions.
Mm-hmm. The parents are an exception, obviously. Mm-hmm. Now, still talking about parents, if we are finding our way back to this parent. Is it possible, we are Gen Z's here, I don't know if there are people that have exceptions of experiences, to set boundaries with our parents? Is that a thing that can happen?
Is it possible?
Your parents don't believe that there should be any boundaries between you and them.
Exactly
what Barrister said, copyrights of a parent could have a copyright and a child have a copyright. Some parents will be like, are you going to be teaching me what I am supposed to know? Like, a child cannot will be afraid that, okay, what if I don't tell them about this and don't, or what I want in my life?
It brings me to this personal experience I had. When my mom just, when I was in my mid-teens years, and they just got me a phone. It was an Android phone. I was having the time of my life. And guess where in the house I used to spend most of the time, anytime I enter that place?
Not my bedroom.
I shared my bedroom with my younger brother.
Convenience.
He was in the toilet. Let's begin. So when I was in the toilet, my mom was, I could go 30-40 minutes. I knew I would just, sometimes I just like, that was my, that was my own study, so to speak. I would be there and I knew nobody would disturb. If you bang the door, turn back, I'm busy. Until I came out one day, and after some months, my mom just came, what are you doing in that place? And I felt like, how is it your...
Parents are supposed to be vigilant.
Yeah.
You see, when a child recludes, reclusion is dangerous. A lot of factors are involved. When a child is being bullied at school, when he's on drugs, he's discreet.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. When he starts to use perfume every 3 minutes, find out what I address
smoking.
This thing we say, parents, our mentor, protect our mental health, parents help us. I believe also that some of the Gen Z, they are also supposed to help to protect their parents' mental health too, whether their parents are saying it or not.
Okay, that's another spin.
I know how we make demands. When you see the economy has so made situations in families where you have 4 or 5 persons,
mm-hmm.
yes,
and the 5 of them want an iPhone at the same time.
Okay,
and parents will have to offer.
Okay, I see where Barrister is coming from now. I understand.
The 5 million naira to get an iPhone for the five of them.
Mm.
Now, if there's okay, let the eldest, the 2 eldest, you know, get these gadgets. The younger ones
pend it.
Will start protesting to use, to have a time with those phones.
Yes.
Then the elder ones will refuse. Once the elder ones refuse, the younger ones will go back to the parents and begin to lay fresh demands for equality. You understand? So there you find that the parents are overstretched.
in a way, them overthink.
Yes, they are overstretched.
That's true. We never consider mental health.
Because we think about the only human
being. It has never occurred to us before. There's a discussion we should have about how the problem we are well, okay.
So, I think
to work, waking up early, preparing food for the children to eat, to go to school, paying their school fees, even paying for other things again.
Yes.
Imagine fuel, now that there's increment in fuel price, have to fuel your car.
Do you get it? That is how they know how to.
I remember some time ago when I take my children out, I will park somewhere. I use the ATM. I've been doing that. For, I didn't know they were noticing that. And my son asked me one day that he needs this card, that he needs his own of this card. So I wanted to know why he thinks he needs that
card. How old was he?
He was 10 then.
Okay.
He's 13 now.
Okay.
So he said he needs that card. And I said, okay, why do you need the card? He said he needs it like that. They used to give, there is not government that put money so that when he has a card, he can go there and take money, the one who used to take money. The federal government that's funding him. That's what So, they have another discussion, my son and my daughter. They have another discussion, what they were telling their mom that money's data just finished anyhow. That is data does not finish.
it's only
when you go us, they'll use the hotspot, connect to the TV, connect to their cartoon, to their tablets, and when I'm around, that's when they can connect.
Yes.
That's when I'm back from work.
Yes.
Because my phone has to be close to them to connect. And when they connect, it's only needed until they sleep and wake up, they continue.
They continue.
They just believe that is a warehouse.
I
cannot explain to them that they need to exploit me to size and protect my mental health. Because I will not, because I'm supposed to give to them.
It feels weird.
So I'm just using that as an example. Not like what they are expending is anything. Okay, but children should grow up to a stage where they look at their parents and say,
okay,
I wish I can give back.
Okay.
Because most children today, by the time they get to the age where they are able to give in the economy, where they're able to give back to the home front, they've lost either mommy or daddy. There are people I've met friends who said, one of my friends were discussing. He just broke down. I said, what is it? Well, he has a bipolar.
Okay.
So if I just switch from one emotional condition, if you remind him of something, he just remembered his mother, who's already late, and he was in tears. But how I wish I am sitting here with my mom. I will empty my treasure and make sure that she has the best of life.
That is a very
sad. Mom is not there. The dad is not there. So what he does is anytime he remembers them, he calls his younger ones and use them as a point of contact. So that his ancestors, his parents, wherever they are, will see that he's doing that for the younger ones.
Our parents are humans too.
So anytime we take a discussion like this and make it unidirectional, at the end of the day, we'll be going against the course of nature. What God really wants us to do is not to think about ourselves, but to think about others. Because it is when you have others in mind and your projection. You see, our friends also have mental health issues.
They are human beings.
Our teachers too.
They are human beings.
You understand?
They are going all the real hardships and everything.
So we should also take that into consideration in the discourse.
To add one personal experience, this one might make you laugh a little bit. I was probably 11. Or 12. Don't judge my mom. What I'm about to say. My mom is a twin. Yeah, I don't know if mom, if you're watching this, don't come for me. My mom is a twin, and our twin sister, she stays some 4 streets away. So when she cooks, sometimes she just brings it over there. Okay, I just prepare this. Just so I was the only one at home. She bought soup. So as you bought the soup, the fish was looking so good.
Yeah, you munched it.
Kai, Kai.
I just took, you know, I broke. It's something I used to do then. I used to be in charge of, I'm the second born. So most of, second born, you understand what I'm saying. Most of the chores, I was the one calling the shots. So I took the fish and I ate it. So the fish being, you know, what's the word? New soup. It just broke. It was obvious that someone had tampered with this thing. Let me go back first before my younger brother or my elder brother. And she came and said, Utos system. There was no Utos system. I was the only one at home. She said, Ofe Jali. In English, so you want to be stealing. That's what she was. My mom locked the door. She stripped me naked.
Yeah.
And emphatically beat stealing out of my body. I remember she finished beating me. She was in fact, and she was, now I remember when she was beating me, the fear in her head was, they might bring this boy home one day that he took someone's phone, or he took someone's, you want to bring shame. I'm sure she was, her mind was traveling, and she was just lying, nothing. When she was done, I went to the balcony and I was by myself. The whole house was watching TV, I was just alone, that this woman, maybe you bought me. My dad had to call me in the night and did the old good cop, bad cop. Well, yeah, come here. You know, we don't like things. But at the end of the day, it's not like she, someone would claim that she has scarred me. And in my own head, I don't feel she scarred me. I feel in her own justification, she didn't want a thief.
But was it really that? Did it need to be that extreme?
Yes, yeah, she had to be emphatic if you ask.
Well, it's you did. I've never. You don't do that. You just go to the port and take meat.
No, there's the meat. No,
you did it in the port.
Without permission, as a child.
But
in my era, you cannot go to the port and take it. Today, Gen Z's, they go and take soup by themselves from the port. It's an offense in those days. That you just broke
that's the word protocol. It's not necessarily the means.
See, I'm not you guys are simplified life.
Life should be simple.
Well, no, it shouldn't that's be made liberalized to a teenager or someone who is just coming up. You know why? You see, because you're not gonna end up in that house. From that house you will go out. And whatever you are gonna be an ambassador of that house. It's not like your parents deliberately want to make you, you know, and all that. No. I shared a story yesterday of how when we were at the Air Force barracks, okay, there's this car. So soldiers, they buy a car when they go for peace mission. And when they buy these cars, they come back, they're not able to maintain it. So they just remove the tires and push stone around. This particular one, we go there to play. One day I was there with my brother. We went to the car, we came out. And my friends came out and I forcefully jammed the door. And the windscreen broke. Mm-hmm. 1989, the windscreen broke at PWD Air Force Base, Ikeja. Now, my dad is brutal. The finest of Air Force soldier, finest. My dad writes for you like it's typed, like somebody types it, bio.
The caliber.
The measure, is everything is
as one by one.
You don't have to do things. The good thing is, I cannot hire my dad's uniform. I won't get the lines.
The gator must be.
I won't get it.
As sharp as
as disciplined as he was, for the first time in my life, my dad is senior officer. Went to a junior officer in the force, knelt down and begged him. I was broken.
As a consequence of what you did?
Yes. Oh. And eventually paid. In 1989, 12,000 naira. 12,000 naira in 1989 is almost 10 million today. Now, when that happened,
yeah, some of us just break.
When that happened, I couldn't talk to my dad again. What I did thereafter was, when he goes to work, I'll go to his room, sweep
everything.
Because he was going to take out all his clothes, wash them. you know, pack them. Make sure that everywhere is packed.
So lines are
to be drawn. With all that, you want to talk. So I'm just saying that we must get to that point where, you know, no matter what it is, you don't cast aspersion on your parents on the strength of discipline. Or to say that we have to be disciplined. It is important. Even scripture say when you spread the rod,
you spread his hand.
But
I was telling
I want to ask this question. We were talking about the Child Rights Act.
Yes.
Is physical abuse not part of it?
No, discipline
is different from
discipline is allowed.
That's for Nigeria,
yes,
right?
Discipline is allowed, but the discipline abusing a child physically or injuring a child or giving a child marks, tribal marks, that one itself is the penalty is 3 years in prison.
Tribal marks, is that not
No, it's not allowed. That the name of a child is sufficient to identify him.
We don't know.
The child that has is 2004 now. So before 2004, you can give tribal marks, you can tattoo, tear the child.
But currently, people are still actually giving their children that actual tribal marks.
Yes, now because no one is petitioning them. The law does not enforce itself. For example, now, I do a lot of women and children in the law.
Yeah.
If a child is born in my presence and you are drawing any knife and I say no, and you continue, I'll bring a petition to protect the child. You understand?
Yeah.
It's just that our country has broken down. We don't have, we're barely talking about, so as we're talking now, some children are being kidnapped in the bush now. Asking village to bring money. The village, whole village have massacred everywhere.
15 million.
You understand? So, we are in a difficult situation.
Very, very difficult.
Well, mental health is real, but never want to be taken as a tool for exploiting parents or anyone else.
Mm-hmm.
But that's how far we can go on the show today. Thanks for watching. Join us again next week. Bye. Bye.
Enterprise TV, a tradition of truth.